Welcome back to the next session. I'd like to introduce Krupesh Desai, who's going to be talking to us about big data. Krupesh is a data science enthusiast, I get that right, yeah. Of sorts. Please welcome.
Okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Krupesh, and I work for Nelson Marlboro District Health Board. I work there as a data migration and business intelligence lead. Today I'm going to talk about big data in Python. So I see myself as a data engineer, and I was introduced to big data in 2013 when I was asked to replicate data from Oracle to Hadoop. Now, the scope of the project was limited. We sort of did that, but then I wanted to learn more. I was really excited about the scope of big data, what it can do. So what I did, I packed my bag, left Auckland and come to Nelson because I can save some time in commuting, and I gave that time to my study big data. That's like 2 hours a day, which is good enough. So yeah, and Nelson is good. So it's been like 2-3 years now since I'm learning and practicing big data. I don't claim I'm an expert, but what I want to do today is just to summarize my understanding. So if I'm wrong, at least someone can then guide me properly. Okay? So let's start. So obviously I'm going to start with big data, where I will try to see what exactly big data is. And I will end with data science, because big data and data science are like two sides of a coin. And in that discussion, we will look at MapReduce, Hadoop, and cloud computing. And obviously we're going to look at Python, especially in terms of a preferred choice of language to build big data solution. So what is big data? I believe it's a very confusing term, because the first question it raises is, how big is big data, right? And there is no precise answer to that. In 2014, I found a really good answer to what is big data, and I believe the answer is still relevant. And the answer is that big data is like teenage sex. Everyone talks about it, and nobody really knows how to do it. But everyone thinks that everyone else is doing it, so they claim that they are also doing it. So that's said by this gentleman here, not me. So don't put any kind of offense on me. So let's look at what is big data. Now, to understand big data, we have to first understand what is data growth. Until 2003, we have produced 5 exabyte of data. And now we produce 5 exabyte of data every 2 days. And where this data coming from? YouTube. That's just like few example here. First is YouTube. The video that we upload, total videos we upload in 1 hour, their combined length is 72 hour. So 72 hours of video being uploaded every hour, every day. Twitter, 8 terabyte of tweet every day. Facebook, 10 petabyte of data. You know, what we're feeling and, you know, what photos and what we're feeling, what everything is on Facebook, and that's around 10 petabyte per month, and it's increasing. Internet archives, that is, you know, we have different web pages, blogs, websites, you know, a lot of new web pages being created, which generate internet archive, and that is around 20 petabyte per month. We also have digital footprint, which is, when we watch a movie online or when we read a book using some app, it generates digital footprint around what kind of movie we watch or what kind of book we read, how many pages we read in one go. So that's digital footprint. We also have sensors. So along with RFID sensors, there are web sensors, which is producing data around click streams. For example, which ad you watch or which ad you skip, or do you really buy a product online or you just go to the payment page and close the browser? People do that, right? So that's, I do that. So that's your click stream. So that's generated by web sensor. So in a way, we are producing this humongous amount of data every day. And the first thought or the philosophy or the idea, whatever you want to call it, the thought to process this huge amount of data and create some value out of it, that thought gave the birth to the term big data. Now, and who else it could be? It was Google who pioneered the big data solution, because being Google, you have to first create an index of entire web, update the index on a regular basis, and then have a search on top of that index. So it's a big task. And the solution that they created was called Google Distributed File System. And they released the paper of that. Yahoo picked up, you know, make it more, you know, improve it to fulfill their requirement. And they made it, it was an open source project. So then they released two products called MapReduce and Hadoop. And then the whole buzz around big data started in that 2005-06 time. And all the big enterprises wanted to join in as well. So big data is not just structured data. That's the first thing. The structured data is our normal transactional data, that is rows and column, table, field, you know, relational data, OLTP data. So big, that transactional data or structured data is a part of big data, but big data is not just structured data. It is also semi-structured data and unstructured data. Semi-structured data is like, example, JSON or XML. That's semi-structured. It has a, some sort of a structure. Unstructured would be text file or web logs or images. So big data is all about bringing this different kind of data sources, you know, different variety of data together, crunch them, do a lot of data crunching, data massaging, and produce some value out of it. So that's what big data is. And we are using big data applications. Obviously, Google, you know, Google Analytics, how Google managed to analyze entire web traffic on a regular basis. Then how Twitter gives us the trending topic for each country. Then how Amazon recommend a particular book or particular product when you are buying a similar product. So these are all big data solutions. Now, before we further go into understanding what is big data, it's, you know, we should first look at what is not big data. Now, we all know what is food packets or food packaging. Okay. Now, the technology of food packaging was derived from rocket science or aerospace science, whatever you want to call it. Because astronauts, they have to stay for a long time in space. And therefore, a technology was developed to store the food in a way that it stay as it is for the long time. So we can say that food packaging is a byproduct of rocket science, but we can't say that doing food packaging is same as doing rocket science, right? Similarly, with the rise of big data, there are several technologies which have evolved in terms of processing and storing data. Example, in-memory data storage and data processing, or fault-tolerant Hadoop cluster to store and process data in a distributed manner. Now, if you are doing your OLTP or your transactional database and just writing SQL with this new technologies, that is not big data. Like, if you are running your transactional database in memory, or if you are building a data warehouse on a Hadoop cluster, that's not big data. Okay, because at the end of the day, you are just doing SQL, just dealing with the structured data. So now, how exactly an enterprise can do big data? What is the right way of doing big data? So the right way is asking the right question, what you want to know. Once you have that question, then you can figure out whether you need a big data solution or not. And for that, you can use this analytics continuum. So now, if you can figure out the answer at the descriptive analytics, which is about what happened in past, that is our traditional data warehouse and business intelligence, you know, telling you what was the total sale of last quarter or what was the profit in 2015 in a particular region. So that's descriptive analytics. If you can find answer there, you don't need big data. Okay. The next level is diagnostic analytics. Now, diagnostic analytics is about why things are happening. And it is useful for root cause analysis and fraud detection. The answer of your question, if it is leaning towards prediction, then you need predictive analytics, which is about what's going to happen next. And the last level is prescriptive analytics, where you want the system to generate different recommendations. Now, with each level of this analytics, the amount of volume, variety, and velocity of data will increase. So big data, we can say that big data is about processing data with three V properties: volume, variety, and velocity. But for different big data solution, this three V may vary. Okay, so there is no standard prototype or sort of a framework for that. Every different problem would need a different solution. At the center of big data processing is MapReduce. MapReduce is a programming model, and it has nothing to do with map and reduce function of Python. They're completely different. Okay? MapReduce is a programming model that process large data set and return a collection of key value combinations. You can write a MapReduce program, run it on your local machine, fine. But the real power of MapReduce can be seen when you run that on a parallel distributed environment. For example, here, let's say you have a big text file and you want to know how many times a particular word has occurred, then you can write a MapReduce program to do that and run that in a distributed environment and get your result quickly. And because distributed environment is involved, big data processing is more about horizontal scaling and not vertical scaling. So horizontal scaling is when, as the demand of your data process and data storage increase, you add more machine into an existing cluster. Whereas in vertical scaling, which is our traditional database server, as the demand increase, we add more memory, more processing power, more storage. So big data is more about horizontal and not vertical. Now, I don't want to go into too deep technical side of MapReduce, but let's try to understand it with a very simple example. Let's say there is somewhere in a parallel universe where addition of 10 digits is a big task, or it's a big data task. And being an enterprise, you want to do that. You want to add 10 digits, and the time bound is 1 hour. You want to do that in 1 hour. So there is one PhD guy who says, okay, I can do that. I will charge you $100 for that, and I can do that in 1 hour. Fine, that's one way of doing it. What is the MapReduce way of doing it? So instead of hiring that PhD guy, what we do is we hire one graduate of mathematics or graduate of addition, right? And who can only add 5 digits, and he will charge you $30, and he can do that in 20 minutes. And along with him, we hire 5 high school students who can only add 2 digits, and they're going to charge you $5, and they can do that in 10 minutes. Now, with this team, you can do addition of 10 digits in just 20 plus 10, 30 minutes, and 30 plus 25, $55. So that's the power of MapReduce. Almost half the time, half the price. The condition is that these 5 students should work in parallel environment, right? So that's good. But one critical thing is missing in this example. There should be someone, or must be someone, who is responsible responsible for dividing that 10 digit into subset of 2 digits and handing over that 2 digit to 5 students. When they are done, accumulate the result and hand over to the graduate guy, right? So who's going to do that? That's where we have Hadoop. Now, Hadoop is a framework. Hadoop is a cluster of computers that provide us the parallel distributed environment on which we can run MapReduce program. Okay. Now, a Hadoop cluster can have one or more master node, and it has multiple slave nodes. In our example, we can say the blue guy is our master node, and the high school students are our slave nodes. The backbone of Hadoop is SDFS, which is Hadoop Distributed File System. Now, SDFS is predominantly responsible for dividing your large data set into small subset, distribute among all slave node, copy your MapReduce program, do the process, accumulate the result, hand over to master node, and so on. So SDFS is the core. Now, being an enterprise who wants to do big data, you have to invest in Hadoop. A Hadoop cluster can be of 3 computers, 30 computers, or 3,000 computers. It completely, dependent upon your requirement. So, and you also need human resource, Hadoop administrator, Hadoop engineer. So that's a lot of cost. Now, is there any way to do big data with, you know, more cost efficiently? Yes, of course. That's where we have cloud. So cloud computing is all about using someone else's computer, right? In a very simple way, I can say that. So there are providers like Google, Amazon, and several other who provide Hadoop as a service. So you don't have to invest in Hadoop in-house. What you can do is you can just focus on MapReduce program, and once you are done, run that in a Hadoop cluster, which is somewhere in the cloud. And believe me, it's very easy to run a MapReduce program in cloud. I have an example here. So for this example, I'm using Amazon. And Amazon service is called, Hadoop service is called Elastic MapReduce. So see, you can see it's very easy. What I can do is, obviously I have to create an account on Amazon, and then I can, I have to create environment variable for authentication. Once I'm done with that, what I'm doing here with this first command is, I'm running a MapReduce program written in Python on my single machine, and I'm playing with very small data set, 100,000 record. Once it is running fine, then I go and run that again. I run that again on Hadoop cluster on Amazon, and that's it. I don't have to do much change there; just two new parameters, and that's it. And once they are running fine, then I go for the big data problem. I run that with 1 million records, and now I'm running that on a Hadoop cluster of 20 machine, and just with that one command. I don't have to do anything. This command will go talk to the cluster or talk to the cloud, create the cluster, configure the cluster, copy the data, do everything, and finally give me the output in that file. That's it. I don't even know how to do Hadoop when I'm running this. It's that simple. Now, I know you don't believe me, so I have a demo. Now, you can see here that, be the demo god with us. Oops. Yeah. So I'm running that command with Hadoop cluster with 20 machine running that command, and I have to skip that quickly. It's going to talk to the cluster, create the cluster, and do everything for me, show me the log information, and finally I will get the output in the file. And this is the dashboard of EMR, Elastic MapReduce. It took 42 minutes to run this. And this is by default configuration. And as you can see here, out of 20 machine, one was my master node, and remaining 19 were my slave node, which Amazon called them core node. And this is by default configuration. Okay, I'm not doing anything. This is all by default. So that, therefore, this machine are low-end machine, not a, like a superpower machine. Okay, default configuration is a medium machine, M1.medium. But what you can do is, once you are, you know, getting used to this, what you can do is you can log in and configure the Hadoop cluster beforehand. You can have maybe a Hadoop cluster of 10 machine, each with 256 GB memory or more, and a lot of CPU power. And you can do this in maybe in 4 minutes, not 42. So that's the power of cloud computing. Now let's talk about Python, finally. So why Python? Why I wrote that program in Python? The reason is Python is awesome, first of all, and it's easy to learn and it's very intuitive, we all know that. But the real thing is it got really powerful features to work with large data sets. And the backbone of Python is obviously the vibrant open source community and reusable packages. And remember, in big data, the data will flow from different sources. Transactional data, your JSON, XML data, text, and images. Sometimes you have to scrap websites, different websites, to get data for analysis. So Python already got packages for that. So as a programmer, you don't have to start from scratch. And that saves a lot of our time. Other thing is that in the beginning, apart from Java, programming language R was very popular among the big data and data science community. But from last 5 to 6 years, Python has emerged as a preferred choice of language for big data and data science. And in fact, when I started doing big data, I did R certification. And now I hardly use R, because practically there is nothing that you can do in R which you can't do in Python. There might be a few things which is good in R, but you know, there is no such a task that I can see that you can do only in R and you can't do in Python. And the big advantage is ease of deployment. Now, Python is, you know, it's used for a lot of things, web development, desktop applications, there are ERPs in Python. So when it comes to deploying a big data solution into an existing workflow or in a production environment, Python has a, you know, has an upper hand over R. And obviously the recent release from Google, the machine intelligence library called TensorFlow, I believe it's a, and that's in Python. So I believe that it's a living proof of Python's increasing dominance in the big data or data science community. I have an example here. So let's say we have three users, and user one and two both have watched and rated Star Wars Part 1 and Part 2. For some weird reason, the user three has only watched and rated Part 2. Now, looking at this image, we can easily recommend user three to watch Part 1, right? But how can you automate this recommendation when you have billions of user rating for thousands of movies by millions of users? How do you, you know, automate this recommendation engine? You can do so by writing MapReduce program in Python. And this is our sample data. Like, let's say we have a lot of data like this, user ID, movie ID, rating, and the timestamp. And obviously, we also have a lookup table for movie name, which I have not included here. So you can write a MapReduce program to do that. And there's already a package called MRJob, MapReduce job, in Python that you can use. Now, I don't have time to go into each line here, but what I want to highlight is, as you can see, I'm importing the package, first of all, and use after that, using the feature of MRJob to solve the problem. And at the end here, I'm configuring a pipeline of MapReduce job, because one MapReduce job is not good enough to handle this situation. So I'm creating a pipeline where the output of first MapReduce become input to second and so on. And this is the output of that. And you can see here in the highlighted line there, the Big Night and Rushmore both been rated by 241 user. And their similarity of their rating is almost 0.9654, so almost 0.97, right? Which is out of one. So we can say that if somebody has watched Big Night, you know, we can recommend him Rushmore and vice versa. But how do we get that 0.97? That's where data science comes into picture. So you can figure out the similarity measure between two movie ratings of two movie by using the cosine similarity algorithm. Now, cosine similarity algorithm tells you the similarity measure between two vectors. So therefore, you have to first create vectors of movie rating for all possible pair of movies that have been watched by same user out of that 1 billion. Then only you can apply this algorithm. So that creating that vectors of movie rating is the MapReduce job. And once you have the data ready for data science, then only you can apply data science. So this is what big data and data science is all about. And that's just one way of doing it, by the way, because the cosine similarity is a, actually it falls under the big umbrella of machine learning. And there are several machine learning algorithms as well. So let's look at machine learning. Now, machine learning is all about recognizing patterns in the data and doing predictive analytics with that. And obviously, we are using applications of machine learning now. Have you ever imagined how a traffic camera can read your number plate? You know, and or how an email application can now classify your email as a marketing promotional email, normal social media email, and the inbox. Or whenever you upload photo on Facebook, it highlights human face and asks you to tag. It will never highlight dog or a cat. it will always highlight a human. So a machine is able to understand that there are human faces on a photo. So that's all machine learning applications. Now, there are several machine learning algorithms, but you can classify them as a three type, in a three type. The first is supervised. Now, in supervised machine learning algorithm, you have a lot of data, obviously, and you can see the data in features and outcome. For example, you have, let's say you have all the house prices of entire New Zealand. So your features would be number of bedroom, number of bathroom, total area of the house, whether there's a garage or not, there is a garden or not, what is the city, suburb, right? So these are all features, and outcome is the price of the house. So once you have all this data, you can run supervised machine learning algorithm on that, which gives you a mathematical model. Now with that model, when you have a new house, you can add the feature of that house and it will predict the price. So that's supervised. Unsupervised is you don't see the data as features and outcome, you just have a lot of data and you run unsupervised algorithm and it creates clusters. It divides the data into several clusters. So closely related data will be put in a one cluster. So it is very useful to find outliers and to do root cause analysis, fraud detection. One example could be the fraud, catching the fraud credit card transaction on the fly, not after it had happened and you get a call. You can just catch it on the fly. So that's unsupervised. Now reinforcement, I believe, is a very extreme end of data science. It is the algorithms in reinforcement. They are inspired by how a human face, a human brain react to punishment and reward. And it's used in the system where system has to take small decision without any human guidance. For example, a self-driving car deciding whether to stop or to speed up at a yellow light. So in enterprise big data analytics, my opinion, I don't believe we need to look into reinforcement too much. There might be some case studies where you can use it, but for a normal big data analytics, reinforcement is an extreme level. So, and it's very easy to do this in Python. You can see that the first one here is linear regression, which is a supervised machine learning algorithm. And just few line of code there, 10 line maybe. And this one is also supervised, it's called logistic regression. It is a kind of supervised machine learning algorithm, but here you don't predict outcome like house price. Instead, you predict classification, yes or no, or a digit, a photo of a digit. The digit is 1, 2, 3, or so on. Example of this would be predicting whether an user account is hacked or not based on the clickstream data. So that's logistic regression. You also have k-means, so that's unsupervised machine learning algorithm. And you can see just 8 line and 4 are comment. So 4 line of code. And it will, you know, divide my data into cluster. But remember this, that we have to first prepare the data to do data science. Okay? And this is all because of the package called sklearn. And now you can also use TensorFlow, and there are other packages as well that you can use, which already has all the mathematics done for you. And data scientists are responsible, or you know, they are educated to do this, that they can fine-tune these algorithms to improve the predictability of the algorithm. So that's where data scientists are. And the data engineers are those who actually capture data from different data sources, prepare the data for data science, right? And that's the reason, because of the big data, data scientists are mathematicians trying to learn programming and programmer trying to learn statistics and mathematics. Because that's like two disciplines, you know, merging together. So I will conclude by saying that doing big data right is all about asking the right question, then figure out you need, whether you need a big data solution or not using the analytics continuum. And if you need a big data solution, identify all different data points where the data will flow from. And obviously you have Python packages to manage the different data sources. And do a lot of data crunching with Python, prepare the data for data science. Again, use Python to apply data science. You have a solution, deploy that solution. That's it, thank you.
We do have a few minutes for questions if anyone would like to ask. going once. Yes?
Well, thanks for the talk. That was really informative. I'd like to get into data science, and where do you find some good substantial amounts of data to start with?
I was in the same boat a few years back.
Yeah, where do you find it?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So I believe if you want to learn data science, the first thing you can start with is machine learning, because that's what data science is all about, applying those algorithms. There are a lot of stuff, you know, in machine learning that you can learn, different algorithms, and then you start from machine learning and you go towards deep learning, okay? So that's one discipline. But if you want to be a complete package, also start learning data engineering aspect of it and start with MapReduce. There are a lot of different technologies now, Spark and the heaps actually, several of them. But if you start with MapReduce, it gives you a good journey that you can go from one step to another, because MapReduce is the one where it all started. You know, the first product that came out from Yahoo Research. So you understand MapReduce and then go further. Then you learn Python, different packages of Python, how you can scrape website or how you can load data from Twitter API, Facebook API, or then you have to learn about, you know, managing that JSON and XML files into Python. You can also learn some NoSQL, like MongoDB, DynamoDB, like that, because you have to manage different data sources. Another thing you can learn is how you can do image manipulation in Python. So machine learning to go forward data science, and this data engineering aspect to be a complete package.
Any other questions? Going once, going twice? No? Please join me in another round of applause.
Thank you.